Good morning and welcome to Cross Life Church and to our online worship broadcast. I'm Pastor Darren. Welcome and good to have you here. A special welcome to those who are joining us for the first time. We're so glad that you found us and look forward to worshiping with you today. We're continuing in our Shape series and we're focusing on abilities today. And so I invite you to do a Facebook check-in today, anytime during the broadcast, that says filled and skilled with abilities. Exodus 31. You can also scan this QR code right here and send us a connection card today. That's where the QR code will take you. It just lets us know that you are with us in worship. And I love seeing the names that come through when people send that connection card in. And I also love seeing your prayer requests. You can submit prayer requests on those connection cards too. And the prayer team and I take your prayers before God during the week. A couple announcements for this week. We have available our spiritual gifts assessment. You go online for that. It's free. I put it together for our Cross Life Church. If you are a member of Cross Life Church or a friend in any way and you want to take that spiritual gifts assessment, get online. If you don't have the link, just get a hold of me. I'll get you the link, and we would love to have you take that spiritual gifts assessment. Secondly, save the date. There's a special event coming up here in July, on Sunday, July 25th. We're having our July Jamboree. That'll be a Sunday morning that is packed with good music, with worship, and inviting our community to join us and get to know us here at Cross Life. So watch for more details, plan to attend, even plan to volunteer. It'll be a great Sunday morning on July 25th. So I'm kind of confessing and kind of proud today in this way that I finally admitted this past week. I finally admitted something. I was pretending. I was ignoring it. I was denying it. I would hope it would go away on its own. But I finally admitted that I had this pain and tightness in my back between my shoulder blades and up my neck, and it started Wednesday morning, and I thought, maybe I slept wrong, or it got worse during the day, and it just radiated more, and it got into Wednesday night. I still had it Thursday morning, and it was even worse, but I just ignored it. I said, it'll go away, it'll be fine, and Thursday was even worse. I woke up Friday morning, and it was just bad, and I finally admitted it. I have this brokenness, this hurt, this pain, and I need someone else to take care of it for me. And so I went to the chiropractor, and he took care of it for me. When you are not willing and ready to admit that you are broken and that you are hurting and that you have pain in your life, God's words and promises about forgiveness are just not going to do you any good. But when you admit them, like I finally admitted I had pain in my back and in my neck, when you admit them and God wants you to, here's the truth. All people are broken and hurting. All people need healing. And God forgives anyone, including you. So there's these words in 1 John chapter 1, and they say this: if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, this is God, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar, and his word is not in us. There's a line in the song we're going to sing in just a minute that reflects those words from 1 John chapter 1. And it's talking about churches, it's talking about our church, and we are, including me, we're all flawed people. We are an imperfect church with imperfect people. But what we want to do is we want to admit that, like we're doing right now. And we know that when we admit that, we know that we are forgiven. Please join to sing this song, Start Right Here.
We want our coffee in the lobby. We watch our worship on a screen. We got a rock star preacher who won't wake us from our dreams. We want our blessings in our pocket. We keep our missions overseas. But for the hurting in our city, would we even cross the street? But we want to see the heart set free and the tyrants kneel. The walls fall down and our land be healed. But church, if we want to see a change in the world out there, it's gotta start right here. It's gotta start right now. I'm like the brother of the prodigal, who turned his nose and puffed his chest. He didn't run off like his brother, but his soul was just as dead. What if the church on Sunday was still the church on Monday too? What if we came down from our towers and walked a mile in someone's shoe? But we want to see the heart set free and the tyrants kneel. The walls fall down and our land be healed. But church, if we want to see a change in the world out there, it's gotta start right here. It's gotta start right now. Lord, I'm starting right. The people who are called by His name, if we'll surrender all our pride and turn from our ways, He will hear from heaven and forgive our sin. He will heal our land, but it starts right here. We're the people who are called by His name, if we'll surrender all our pride and turn from our ways, He will hear from heaven and forgive our sin. He will heal our land. It's gotta start right here. It's gotta start right now. Gotta start right here. Gotta start right now. It's gotta start right here. It's gotta start right now.
This next song is about healing brokenness with the forgiveness and mercy of God. And here are the starting lyrics for the song that are so fitting to what we're talking about and singing about. They say, to God, you take our lives, flawed yet beautiful, restore, refine. Lord, you're merciful, redeem, revive. Enjoy singing those words now in the song, Heal Our Land.
You take our lives, yet beautiful, restore, refine, Lord, you're merciful, redeem. Salvation, Christ alone.
Please pray with me. Almighty Lord, thank you for the wide variety of skills and talents you have given to the members of our military. On this Memorial Day weekend, Lord, we pray that you give all members of the military courage and integrity as they seek to use their unique gifts in service to our country. Protect all those in service, protect them from harm and danger. In periods of separation, from their loved ones, stay close to their spouses, their children, their parents and family who suffer from loneliness and persistent worry. God, grant wisdom and integrity to our military leaders and Commander-in-Chief, President Biden, to fight honorably for peace during these difficult and challenging times. Accept our thanks, Lord, on this Memorial Day weekend for military personnel who have served our country, especially for those whose service ended in death when fighting to protect us. Lord, in worship today, unite our hearts in your heavenly peace, open us up to your teaching and your salvation, and lead us to believe in you, our beautiful Savior. Amen. We are here at Cross Life Church to connect people to Jesus and to help believers live a more fulfilling life. We pray that our worship today does that And we'd love to connect with you through the connection card. You can scan this QR code, and we'll also give you a moment right now to do a Facebook check-in, filled and skilled with abilities, Exodus 31. You can take a moment to do those things, and then I will come back and preach today's message. All he did was to raise his staff above the water. And when he did, the sea split in two, and there was a wall of water on the right and the wall of water on the left. And his people, God's chosen people, the Israelites, scurried through, right through the dry ground of the sea, escaping the enemy Egyptians. If Moses was a superhero and he had a name, he would be called Deliverance. That, after all, was really the name, the original meaning of the name Moses, means to draw out or to extract or to deliver. And deliverance was the ability that God had given to Moses. It started at a very young age. Moses was the son of slaves. These were Israelites who were slaves in Egypt. And the Egyptians had given the order to kill all the Israelite baby boys because the Israelites were becoming a bit more numerous and strong and powerful. And so his Israelite mom, hid him in the Nile River. And then Pharaoh's daughter, King Pharaoh, his daughter, came and drew Moses out, delivered him from the Nile River. Moses grew up in the palace in Egypt. He became the prince of Egypt. And at age 40, he was trying to deliver the Israelites on his own people from Egypt, and he killed a man. And that's when the Egyptians were after his head, and the Lord delivered him from Egypt into the wilderness where he spent 40 years. And during that 40 years, the Lord God delivered Moses from whom? From himself. When he was 80 years old then, the Lord called Moses from the burning bush. God was speaking from this burning bush, and he called Moses. He said, Moses, I want you to lead the Israelites now. I want you to lead the Israelites out of Egypt. And Moses says, I can't do it. And God says, yes, you can, deliverance, because I've given you this ability to do what I'm asking you to do. And Moses had a staff at that point, and that staff was his reminder the rest of his life that his abilities, even the ability to do miracles, were all given to him by God and were to be used only for God's purpose. Today we are continuing our series called Shape, S-H-A-P-E, and we've covered the S of shape, which is spiritual gifts. We've covered the H, which is heart. And now we're at the A today, which is abilities. Abilities are natural talents that everyone is born with. They're God-given skills that he gives to people. And then as believers, we use them to do what God wants us to do. So we have a story today that takes place under Moses' leadership. It's in the Old Testament as Moses was leading the people of Israel for 40 years through the wilderness to the promised land. During that time, God had given a design for this deluxe tent of worship that's called the tabernacle, and he told them to build it. And here's what God says to Moses. He says, I have given ability to all the skilled workers to make everything I have commanded you. Now, see this? God commanded them to build the tabernacle, and whenever God commands you, he always gives you a promise. God commanded them to build a tabernacle, and then he promised, I've given the skills necessary to do it to all the skilled workers. I've given the skills. There's nothing you can't do, God says, when I ask you to do it. So these are skills that these workers have. And today, there's all kinds of skills and abilities, whether that's for constructing a building like we are doing at our church and school, or watching children, or cooking macaroni and cheese, or playing tennis. There's all kinds of skills and abilities that God gives. So I found some lists of all these, and the lists are some are short, some are long, but I wanted to give you some examples. And so from one of the lists I found, I'm going to read you a few examples of some abilities so you kind of get the gist of what we're talking about. Here are some examples. Analyzing, cooking, directing, editing, facilitating, landscaping, negotiating, organizing, persevering, recruiting, shopping. Some people have a special gift for shopping. I get that was on the list. Traveling, visualizing, welcoming, writing, just to name a few. Then I searched in the Bible. I said, okay, what kind of abilities can we look for in the Bible? And I found this one, which is a really good story about the prophet Daniel. And the Bible says that God gave the prophet Daniel the ability to interpret dreams, explain riddles, and solve difficult problems. So, not everybody had that ability, but God gave that ability to Daniel. Just like you have abilities that others don't have, and others have abilities that you don't have. And that's so important for us to remember. That's really been a theme as we've worked through this Shape series. And so, I want to highlight the importance of that everybody has different abilities. And so we're going to appreciate the same thing in a different way. We're going to apply the same truth in a different way, and we all have different abilities. And so here's a story that I found that a pastor wrote. It's a very good story that illustrates this. It's a story about a bunch of animals who wanted to start a school. And it says this, the courses included running, climbing, swimming, and flying. The animals decided that every animal should take all the courses. That's where the problem started. The duck was better than his teacher in swimming, but he made only passing grades in flying and was really poor in running. So they made him drop out of swimming and stay after school to practice running. This caused his webbed feet to be badly worn, so his grade dropped to an average in swimming. The rabbit started at the top of her class in running, but because of so much makeup work in swimming, she caught pneumonia and had to drop out of school. The squirrel showed outstanding ability in climbing, but he was extremely frustrated in flying class because the teacher insisted that he start from the ground up rather than from the treetop down. He pulled a hamstring from overexertion, and so he got a C in climbing and a D in running. Finally, the eagle was a problem student and was disciplined for being a nonconformist. For instance, in climbing class, he would beat all the others to the top of the tree, but he insisted on using his own way to get there. Finally, because he refused to participate in swimming classes, the eagle was expelled. So, the point of this story is that God has designed every creature to do what God designs that creature to do, and not something different. And so God has designed you to be you and not to be someone else. You can do what God designed you to do, and you can do it well. Now, I want to talk about something here when it comes to the church and how we involve people in the church. And we love volunteer ministry. If you're watching this and you're a member of a church, including a member here at CrossLife, we just have a heart for ministry involving people. But I want to warn us all about this, and we're working on this at CrossLife, and that's this. I call it the warm body syndrome. And what the warm body syndrome is that there's a gap somewhere in our volunteer ministry, or we want to start a new program, and we think, wow, we need people. And so we just go out and find the nearest person, maybe someone that we know, maybe it's a really positive person who would like to be involved, and we're looking for warm bodies to fill a position instead of matching skills to the position, matching abilities to the position. And so I'm saying it here publicly, if you are involved in volunteer ministry at CrossLife and it's not a fit for your ability, then take the off-ramp and just tell us, hey, this is not a fit. And that's great. And then let's look for something that does fit your ability. And we're working on that at CrossLife and improving that. And I hope if you're from another church, your church is working on that too. Avoid that warm body syndrome. So let's get more into now what your abilities actually are. What are some skills that you are good at? As we talk about our skills and abilities, my encouragement for you is to remember two very important things. The first is this. Be aware of your abilities. And the second is beware of your abilities. All right, let's talk about being aware of your abilities. Know yourself. Know yourself, and don't be embarrassed about the abilities that God has given you. Those are gifts, and He wants you to delight in them and not to have false humility about them. So, for instance, I believe I have the ability to be a public speaker, to be a preacher. All right, now, there's not many people gifted with that ability. There's a very small percentage of people in the world that have that ability. Now, you may think, compared to other preachers and public speakers, I'm at the bottom of the barrel. That's fine. If you think that, I'm not comparing myself to other preachers. I'm comparing myself to everyone in the world and saying, I have an ability to speak publicly. Okay, so what's your ability? Don't be embarrassed by it, but know yourself, and then do a self-assessment. There's a bunch of them out there. I really like one that's called StrengthsFinder 2.0. It's by Gallup, and they changed the name. Now it's called Clifton Strengths. So if you Google that, Clifton Strengths by Gallup, you'll be able to read a book, take an assessment. You could do various levels from any $20 to $30. And there's 34 different strengths, and it tells you your top five. And this is very good. Our staff at CrossLife has done this, and it's really revealing. It's really helpful. And so when I look at that, I know myself, I study that. I realize, actually, when it comes to public speaking, I'm actually more of a writer than a speaker. And so I'm speaking just spontaneously and extemporaneously. Scares me a little bit more than the average speaker. So I need to write out what I'm speaking and then have it in my head and in my heart and then deliver it that way. I know that as I've studied about myself and done a self-assessment. Finally, ask others what you're good at. Ask those who are close to you, who know you, coworkers, people in your family, neighbors. Ask them, other church members who volunteer with you, ask them, what am I good at? And listen to what they say. And as you've asked 10 people and 8 people say, you know, you're really good at planning and organizing. That should affirm what you're thinking about what your abilities are. So be aware of your abilities. And it can be a process to figure those out. That's fine. Take your time. Get involved. Do some exploring. Be aware of your abilities. Now, the second encouragement and truth might be a bit more shocking to you than being aware of your abilities, and that's beware of your abilities. And here's what I mean by that. When you are unfaithful to God in some way, or you hurt other people, more times than not, it's going to involve your strengths, your abilities, not your weakness, not an area that you are not good at, but it'll involve your strengths. See, so our greatest weakness is not what we're not good at. Our greatest weakness is not our weakness. Our greatest weakness is our delusion of our strengths. It's when we have these strengths and we speak the language of that strength, and that's how we operate the best, and so we use that strength when we're unfaithful to God or we hurt others. Here, let me give you some examples. So Moses was given the ability to be a deliverer. Right? Things went south and went bad and became a problem, and Moses was sinning when he believed that he was a better deliverer than God was. And it was bad, it was a problem, it was a sin when Moses in Egypt thought he would lead the people out of Egypt, and he killed a man thinking he was starting a revolution, thinking he would save them, and God had not given him permission to kill that man. It was a sin. That's when God extracted him out of Egypt and had to deliver Moses from himself and teach him humility for 40 years. Then as he led the people in the wilderness, there was a time that Moses struck a rock with his staff, and God didn't tell him to do that. He was trying to get water. See, and then Moses, there were a time where he wasn't delegating and wasn't sharing the leadership with the people, and his father-in-law had to come and tell him, Moses, you need to delegate. You need to give some things away. You're not in charge. You're not the king. You're a deliverer, but not the deliverer. See, so that's what it looks like by using our strengths to be unfaithful to God and even hurt other people. Let me give you another example. When the Bible says about the prophet Daniel that he had the ability to solve difficult problems. Have you ever met someone who has that ability to solve difficult problems? Here's what that person operates like. Here's what they look like. First of all, they can be very negative people because they see the problems and everything. They tend to see the glass half empty instead of half full. They're good at solving problems, so they're going to see problems all around the place. And then they're going to be very convinced that their solution is always the right solution and that their opinion is always the right opinion. They're going to tell you what sunscreen you should use or not use. They're going to tell you the be-all, end-all cure to hiccups. They're going to tell you what the government should or should not be doing as if that's going to solve all the problems in the world. See that? So they have the gift, and if when they don't beware of having the gift and using the gift and managing it well, that's when it creates problems. So for the times that you and I use our abilities, our talents, our gifts from God, we don't beware. It's like evil superpowers used against God, against others, for sinful purposes. Maybe you have the ability to use humor. And you have used humor in a way to manipulate others. Maybe you have a gift, a talent for writing. You've used writing in a way, sarcastic or powerful writing, in a way that hurt others. Maybe you have an ability to negotiate. You can negotiate so well that you've exploited and manipulated others with your skills of negotiating to get something for yourself instead of putting their interests ahead of your own. That's how we use our strengths, just like Moses did, and then God needs to deliver us too. And who does he need to deliver us from? He needs to deliver us from ourselves. And he does. He delivers us from ourselves, and here's the good news, he doesn't make us to be anyone else. He lets us be us. The me that God made me to be, he still allows me to be, even when he needs to deliver me from me. So it's Memorial Day weekend here. We give thanks to all of those men and women in the service of our country who have died and given the ultimate sacrifice for our freedom. There's a saying that goes around, typically around Memorial Day weekend, and that saying is, all gave some gave all. What a great reminder. We can plug that into this lesson today, this teaching, and say that we all have some gift. And then I like to put it this way, one gave all, and that's Jesus. Jesus gave all. If Jesus had an ability, he can only name one, he had many of them, but if you could name one, I would say the ability that God the Father gave to his son Jesus was Redeemer. That would be that actually is a name, a title that we call Jesus, Redeemer. And to redeem means to ransom something, to pay a price and to rescue it. In a sense, Jesus was also a deliverer like Moses, but he was a much better deliverer. And so Jesus had the ability to pay a price. He paid with his own life, the ultimate sacrifice, to redeem you, to to rescue you from yourself, to deliver you from yourself. That's what he did for Moses. And it comes into play here then when they're building the tabernacle. So God told Moses, verses 2 and 3, I have chosen Bezalel, and I have filled him with the Spirit of God. The word chosen there actually means called by name. And so there was a name on this job for leading the construction project of the tabernacle. There was a name on that job, and that name, only the name Bezalel would do it, and God named Bezalel to do that job. God had his name all over it. That's the point. He named Bezalel to lead that project. Why did he name Bezalel to do it? Because God had already filled him and skilled him. God had filled Bezalel with the Holy Spirit, with the Spirit of God. And so Bezalel, being a human being like the rest of us and being flawed and broken, had made mistakes before, had used his gifts to sin against God and people before, and God is saying, but I have filled Bezalel with my Holy Spirit, and I've emptied him of all that bad stuff. There is no sin in Bezalel anymore when my Spirit fills him. He hasn't made mistakes. He's not a failure. He's not guilty of anything. He doesn't have to be ashamed. He hasn't let me down. He's filled with my Spirit, God says, and the same is true of you. And secondly, Bezalel worked for a deliverer who is greater than Moses. He worked for that Savior named Jesus. That Savior, God the Father, who designed and created Bezalel, brought him into this world, God the Spirit, who filled him, God the Son, Jesus Christ, who would go on to save Bezalel from himself when Jesus died on the cross and rose from the dead, filled him, and now they give him skills. They skilled him as well. And here's what it says, that God skilled him with wisdom, with understanding, with knowledge, and with all kinds of skills to make artistic designs for work in gold, silver, and bronze, to cut and set stones, to work in wood, and to engage in all kinds of crafts. Have you ever started a project and you couldn't finish the project because you didn't have the right tool? It's never that way with God. With God, he always gives you every ability you need to do what he asks you to do. Do you ever finish a project? You complete a project, and afterwards you look at it, and you're like, oh, it doesn't meet your expectations. It's not what you had hoped it would be. That is never true when you're doing what God wants you to do and using the abilities God has given you. When you use God-given abilities, you shine, and your work shines every time. Have you ever improved a skill, an ability that you have, and when you've improved it, you've really appreciated and enjoyed your new and improved performance? God did that for Moses. Moses could not deliver the Israelites from Egypt when he was 40 years old, and he tried on his own and he failed. It took another 80 years for Moses to finally, when he was 120 years old, deliver the Israelites to the promised land. God developed Moses all of those decades of Moses' life with patience and understanding and mercy and power, and God develops you too. So what I'm saying is this: be aware of your abilities, but even more so, even more importantly, be aware of God. I like this verse at the end of 1 Corinthians chapter 10. It says, whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. God fills you and he skills you with everything you need to do that he asks you to do. So when you do that and you do it for him, you and your work will always shine. Amen. Let's pray. God, thank you for taking us to this ancient story of Moses and the building of the tabernacle and helping us to see how you, God, have gifted Bezalel and Moses and all the construction workers, even God, as you gift people today with natural abilities. Thank you, God, on behalf of everyone praying with me, thank you for our abilities that you give to us. We pray that we use them, God, for your glory and according to what you want us to do, how you have designed us, and the purpose that you have set before us. We pray that we we shine with them, that we enjoy them, God, and that you get the glory. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Kids, stay tuned for the children's message. We're going to talk about abilities. I'll see you there. Hey kids, look what I have here. Do you know what this is? You probably are calling it a Frisbee, but what if you hadn't seen one of these before? You had never seen it, and you really didn't know what it was. What might it be? Well, it maybe could be a dinner plate. It could be a dog dish where you put dog food or water and your dog eats or drinks. It could be a semi-hard hat. It could be a steering wheel. It could be any of those things, right? But you maybe you're laughing right now. It's not any of those things. You know that it's a Frisbee and nothing else. It is designed to be a Frisbee, and so we want to use it as a Frisbee. God designed you with special abilities to be and to do what he made you to be and do. And those are called abilities or skills. And we have a verse in the Bible that tells us about that. In Exodus chapter 31, God says, "I have given ability to all the skilled workers to make everything I have commanded you." God gives you the ability to do what he wants you to do. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for my abilities. They are very special. And I pray, God, that I use them for you and your purposes and your glory. And all God's people said, amen. So there are skilled workers working today, just like there were skilled workers working on the tabernacle in ancient times. There are skilled workers working on our church and school building to finish it up so that we can be in the building in August and start school. But I got to tell you, that building is not the finish line. It's the starting point for our mission ahead. That building, just like the tabernacle wasn't heaven, it wasn't the end, and our building isn't heaven, it's not the end. It's the starting point, it's the starting line. The building is a tool to build something bigger, and that's the kingdom of God. So we say to God, God, our building is a tool for you, and we sing to God now, build your kingdom here.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil while we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We church, and we need your power in us. We seek your kingdom.
Well, we made a good start today, but we're not done yet. We're continuing with crosstalk today as we unpack a bit more about abilities. I'll show you some other scriptures about using abilities and maybe help you discover yours. So get that Zoom app open and join us for crosstalk. I'll see you there in a minute.